Before you go to religion, religion is, throw it out of the picture. I'm not discussing religion with you. It's not religion. Forget religion. Who cares about religion?
What? Forget religion? You may be wondering why I said that. There's only one way to find out. Let's watch the video.
Me, I don't know. I'm one person.
Put your agnosticism aside. Atheists don't exist. Atheism as an idea exists, but atheism or atheists don't exist, because most atheists, all atheists I believe, are agnostics. They just don't have enough conviction to believe in a creator, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there is, because to claim to be an atheist, it is a position to hold, and you have to sustain that position with evidence. Can atheists prove God doesn't exist? Absolutely not.
No,
they cannot.
But in the same token, I think that you can't prove that God
exists. No, we can. We can prove. It depends on how you define evidence.
So
if you are purely naturalistic, if you don't want to go into metaphysical discussions, philosophical discussions, then we are limited with evidence. Then we are confined to your view of evidence. Okay. What do we mean by evidence? Evidence, you have to expand, you have to argue philosophically, you have to look at metaphysical realities as well.
The reason I asked him about the nature of evidence or the definition of evidence is that, so when discussion is entirely science-based, they are confined to evidence that is purely naturalistic or empirical evidence for that matter. But there are other types of evidence one can use, for example, reasoning, okay? You can use calculations. You can use common sense, for example. Common sense. So there are metaphysical discussions, there are metaphysical ideas, there are philosophical evidences or arguments that lead to firm conclusions. For example, philosophically, you can defend certain ideas with certain arguments, right? Those arguments based upon a philosophical discussion can lead to convictions. That's why we cannot just simply say that evidence is only empirical, it is only naturalistic, it is something you can see, sense, or feel. Rather, it can be deduced philosophically. You can reach conclusions philosophically, and those things are real. Those conclusions are actually reality. So this is what I meant when I asked him about the nature of evidence. What do you mean by evidence? What's your definition of evidence? So one has to define evidence before you even proceed with the discussion.
What do we mean by evidence? Evidence, you have to expand. You have to argue philosophically. You have to look at metaphysical realities as well.
So in Islam, the evidence is that everything is so complicated and that we are the way that we are.
Islam,
you were saying the I.
In Islam, the evidence is the universe is not self-created. We did not create it. Okay? It did not create itself. Then where did it come from? It has a beginning. It has a beginning.
I agree with that, yeah.
Yeah, there you go. So this is the evidence in Islam. It's directly from the Quran. What I just said, it is directly from that book, that the universe did not pop into existence by itself or out of nothing, number one. Number two, we did not create the universe, the humans, okay, or any other species for that matter. And it did not create itself because it cannot create itself. Okay, it cannot, for it to create itself, it has to be in existence in the first place, right? Okay?
See, I don't know. I don't feel like I know enough or I'm smart enough to about the creation of the universe.
Put your agnosticism aside.
I asked him to put his agnosticism aside because people come with baggages, mental, psychological, intellectual baggages to a discussion. So I wanted him to empty his mind and listen to my reasoning. Because when you have your intellectual baggage and it is confined to a particular definition of evidence, then you have to free your mind for a few moments so that you can actually have a discussion based upon common sense, right? So that's why I wanted him to put his baggage aside, his intellectual convictions aside, whatever they may be, so that we can have a discussion with an empty mind, with a mind empty of prejudices or biases. So this was the reason why I asked him to put your agnosticism aside, so that we can have a fruitful discussion free of baggages, intellectual baggages.
Put your agnosticism aside. Go with facts. Go with things you can assess, not things you don't know about, right?
Right.
There are many wild ideas out there in human minds. Many, many wild ideas. If we start taking every single idea seriously, then we are in big trouble, right? That's why we have to go with facts. What are the facts? The facts are the universe exists. We agree,
yeah,
right?
I agree. Yep, yep.
We agree it had a beginning, right?
Yeah.
We both agree,
yep.
Right? Then there are three options. It came from nothing. Can that be a possibility?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
No, nothing comes from nothing. That's a logical impossibility.
That's, I don't know enough about the universe.
No, nothing comes from nothing. Okay, that's a logical impossibility. So you're now being illogical.
Okay, okay.
Okay, so yeah. So the universe, first option is it came from nothing. That option is out.
Okay, okay. I'm
the second option is it created itself. That option is out. Logically,
the third option being something created it.
Something created. I mean, we. The third option is we, the humans, or the species. We created it. That option is also out because there is no evidence for that. We are not kept. We are within the universe. We are within the universe. We cannot be. And if these three options are out, then what is the only option left? An all-powerful, let's say, albeit unknown entity,
right,
created the universe, put it there, and this entity has to have at least two qualities, if not more. At least two qualities. Number one, extremely powerful.
Yep, yep.
Because the universe contains immense power. We have billions of galaxies, and even if we were to look at our own galaxy, we see immense power. What do I mean by power? We see energy. We see planets. Let's talk about our solar system. Let's narrow the discussion down to our solar system. Our solar system consists of the sun that shines upon us right now. It's a burning ball of fire each and every single second. I mean, it's right now. You can't look at it. You
yeah.
can't. I mean, if you look at it, you can see it, but you can't look at it because it will, you know, basically it will damage your eyes.
Right? Yeah.
Okay, why? Because there is immense light coming from it. Where is this light coming from? It's coming from explosions taking place on the surface. The heat is coming from those explosions. The radiations are coming from those explosions. And each one of those explosions or one of those flares, when the explosion takes place, you see those flares? Each one of those flares is equivalent to at least, if not more, 200 billion atomic bombs. How many?
2 billion?
200.
200 billion?
200 billion. Can you imagine 10 atomic bombs going off on this planet?
Yeah, yeah.
So, with our modern technology?
So I get what you're saying, like everything is so powerful.
No. It doesn't stop there. It's a lot bigger than that.
Okay, I'll keep going.
These explosions. So now the sun is so powerful, it contains so much energy, it is forever exploding, forever burning, non-stop. We don't know the supply of energy. We don't know the source of energy. It's happening. We know it's happening. And then it's rightly placed. It has a constant. It has been placed at a spot that if it was moved backwards or forwards, we would cease to exist.
Yeah.
We, the planet Earth, would cease to exist. So it's like a clock.
Yeah.
It's like a very sophisticated system, the solar system in particular. Forget about the galaxy. Forget about our galaxy and billions of other galaxies and what they contain. Okay? So I'm trying to explain to you the power of the one who has put all of this there.
Yeah, and it's nuts. If there is one, it's crazy.
So it is very important to explain to agnostics as to the power of the entity who put the sun there to burn consistently for millions of years. Okay? For millions of years, this ball of fire is burning and we don't know the source of this energy. We don't know the source of this. I mean, you need a lot of gas, a lot of, a lot of things happening in the sun for it to burn continuously, nonstop, okay? And we don't know how long it's going to go on for, okay? So where is the source of power coming from? Where is the source of energy coming from? Heat is energy, right? Light is energy, okay? We can look at all these things. So this is why it is so important to explain to agnostics, people who have doubts about the existence of the Creator. It is very important to highlight these things, that where is this immense power coming from? That's very important.
So I'm trying to explain to you the power of the one who has put all of this there.
Yeah, and it's nuts. If there is one, it's crazy.
No. To me, it's clear. There is no if, and there is no but. There is someone, because look, the solar system is far more sophisticated than your skyscrapers and your private jets you fly around on your computers. It's far more sophisticated than that. It's mathematically placed. It's mathematically planned. Okay? And it cannot just fall into place by an accident, right? Because accidents occur again and again. They can happen anytime. And we know we've been here for millions of years, and we are still we're still surviving. We still get the right amount of heat, the right amount of light, the right amount of radiations, okay? Yeah. If the sun is moved from its constant where it is right now, let's say an accident happens, the sun moves from its place, a few yards backwards.
Yeah, we're screwed, yeah.
We're finished, we're gone.
Yeah, yeah.
So now, you tell me, there are two options. There is no third option. Either this is uncontrolled, unplanned accident that happened and here we are. Or it is planned, controlled, and here we are. There is no third option. There is no third option. And this is what we are told in the Quran, that these are three options. The universe, it came from itself. Or it came from nothing. Or you created it. If these three options don't exist, then think of a fourth option, which is the creator, or the maker, or the designer, the sustainer, the planner. Call him what you like. Call him what you like.
And this is my question, because I'm so ignorant towards Islam. I don't even know your prophet. It's Muhammad, right? And
how do you know he doesn't exist?
No, we have evidence that he exists. I'm not saying that he doesn't exist. Yeah. I'm asking, I want to know more about your religion.
First question is God. I'm okay. Jazakallah. First question is God.
The most important point is God's existence. Okay, does God exist? Before we go on to the religion, before we go on to the law of Islam, before we go on to the Prophet of Islam, before we go on to other things within Islam, we need to establish for an agnostic whether God actually exists. That point is very important. Once you establish that God actually exists and there is plenty of evidence or plenty of reason to believe so, then we can move on to other points of discussion.
Yeah. I'm asking, I want to know more about your religion.
First question is God. I'm okay. Jazakallah. Question is God.
And who is God in Islam? I'm not sure.
Okay, God.
I'm just trying to learn.
God is the one I explained to you just now.
Right.
This is God. To us, this is God. The powerful. And now the second quality I was going to come to. The first quality, the first characteristic is power. Immense, extreme power that you cannot measure. Me and you cannot measure. All of us put together with our calculators and devices, we cannot measure his power, because we don't even know what's out there. We don't even know what's out there. We only know what we can see with our little devices and little telescopes and the Hubble and whatever other names. Hubble telescope and all those. And I'm sure there are more sophisticated things now. Okay, I'm a bit, how can I put it, outdated?
Yeah.
On these things. I'm not a scientist. I don't study science. I'm a theorist. I study history. So I'm just trying. I'm trying my best to explain these things philosophically.
So I am a scientist, and I think that's why I struggle with religion. Any religion, trying to pick one or the other.
Before you go to religion, throw it out of the picture. I'm not discussing religion with you. I'm discussing how did the universe come about? How did we get this solar system? How did we get our galaxy, and then billions of other galaxies? Where did this come from is the question. It's not religion. Forget religion. Who cares about religion? Religion comes later, brother. Religion is very, very late.
The reason we don't discuss religion with agnostics or self-proclaiming atheists is because they have baggages, again, intellectual baggages. They have perceptions of Islam, for example. Okay, they think Islam is very similar to Christianity and other religions, right? So they come with these preconceived ideas about religion, or the religion of Islam in particular. So that's why we don't jump to the religion or points of religion, for example, when we discuss these points with atheists and agnostics, rather we go straight to the existence of God. That's the first point we have to discuss in order to make the discussion fruitful. Once we establish the existence of God, then understanding religions and why they came becomes easier.
Before you go to religion is, throw it out of the picture. I'm not discussing religion with you. I'm discussing how did the universe come about? How did we get this solar system? How did we get our galaxy? And then billions of other galaxies. Where did this come from is the question. It's not religion. Forget religion. Who cares about religion? Religion comes later, brother. Religion is very, very late. First, we need to address the entity that is responsible for all of this. Either it's an accident, a grand, magnificent, civilized accident. Civilized accident. I'm calling it a civilized accident, right?
Yeah. You cannot have a civilized accident, right? But the reason why we call it a civilized accident is because if you claim that the sun and other planets fell into their places, and then lo and behold, we had the solar system, and then every single planet is positioned for our life to exist on planet Earth, because if we were to mess with other planets, our life on planet Earth would be affected directly, right? So it's as if there is a planner, a grand creator, a grand architect out there who created all of this to have life on this planet, planet Earth, right? Why would that happen? Okay, so if it's an accident, it is a very, very civilized, a very, very sophisticated accident. In other words, it's not an accident. It is actually a planned event. It happened due to a creator, a powerful entity. That's the point.
Civilized accident. I'm calling it a civilized accident, right? Yeah. Or this is not an accident. This is a planner, a very powerful entity, and who is not only powerful, also very intelligent. Very, very intelligent and wise. How? Because in order to make this solar system, you have to be very intelligent. You have to be able to calculate. You have to have cognition. You have to have a will. You have to have power to implement, to apply that will. Okay, so all of these characteristics are there. We can actually deduce these characteristics from what we see around us. So this is very, very important. Now you tell me whether this is an accident or this is intentional implementation of a plan.
Me, I don't know. I'm one person.
Okay.
And I'm what open is it, to the what, idea what, of
what
any
is more, looking at what I said, what is more probable?
I don't even know if I can put like a probability on things, to be honest.
What makes more sense? A plan, a design, mathematics, which is definitely the case. There is mathematics between the sun and the earth. There is mathematics going on, right? The solar system is mathematically placed. Not only the sun, in fact, other planets are directly relevant to our existence on this planet. If you mess with the moon, if you mess with forget the sun, leave the sun in its place. You mess with the moon, what do you think is going to happen?
I mean, I'm not an astrophysicist, but okay. I'm sure a bunch of things have become out
and,
of whack.
And it doesn't stop. The ecosystem we have on this planet, the ecosystem, how animals live, the bee, just mess with the bee. Mess with the bee, and that's it.
Having talked about the universe, then bringing it down to the solar system, from the solar system you bring it down to planet Earth. And this is what Allah does in the Quran. Amazingly, this method is taken from the Quran. Allah talks about the creation of the heavens and the earth in a number of different places in the Quran. Then Allah talks about the solar system, okay? When Allah talks about the creation of the sun, okay, وَجَعَلْنَا سِرَاجًا وَهَّاجًا وَأَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْمُعْصِرَاتِ مَاءً ثَجَّاجًا لِنُخْرِجَ بِهِ حَبًّا وَنَبَاتًا. So Allah mentions the sun as a ball of burning fire, right? And then immediately Allah brings it down to planet Earth, where rain happens because of the water cycle, because of the sun. And then from that rain we get habitation. So Allah uses arguments like the creation of the universe, then the creation of the solar system. Then from that solar system, we get a number of benefits, for example, the water cycle. And then from the water cycle, we get habitation on planet Earth, which gives us life. So this is an absolutely amazing way to argue, and it is taught directly by Allah. Allah Himself teaches us these arguments in the Quran. That's why they're very powerful. So we need to use these arguments step by step, talk about the creation of the universe, then the solar system and its sophistication and the power that's needed to make it, and then bring it down to the planet Earth, where we see multiple things happening. You know, similar things, similar civilized accidents, if they are accidents, are taking place on a daily basis. Every single second, every single microsecond, these accidents are taking place on planet Earth. Could this all be an accident, or is this actually controlled, sustained, planned, intended, and all of that?
The bee. Just mess with the bee. Mess with the bee. And that's it. Game over. Right?
So, I don't know about game over, but
I hear you. I mean, these are very basic examples I'm giving you, childish examples. These are childish examples.
Okay.
Let's not get sophisticated. Let's get childish, right?
Okay.
Even if you use two brain cells, you don't have to use all those brain cells in your brain. Two brain cells. You can see, hold on a second, this cannot be an accident. This is not an accident. This is not unplanned, random events. This is someone giving those wings to the bee, the ability to go around, okay, do what it does, and then facilitate our ecosystem. And then it doesn't, I mean, if we come to planet Earth on this little tiny dot in the grand scheme of things, there is a lot happening here in the planet Earth. Before we get to the sun, the solar system, and then beyond, in our galaxy, within our galaxy, and beyond, within all of those billions of galaxies, there is a world that's not known to us.
Yeah, for sure.
All of this is not accident, my brother. This is not accident.
I'm open to that idea, yeah.
Okay, you're open to that idea. I'm glad you're open now. Okay, open a bit more. Okay, open your heart a bit more. Don't be biased towards evidence and basic facts that you can actually assess and see. All of this, just be very basic. There are two options. There is no third option. There is no third option. Either this is all a very magnificent civilized accident that continues to happen. It's not stopping, is it? These accidents are not stopping. We are still getting mathematically planned species popping up every single day. Right now as we speak, things are coming into being, okay, according to a system. There is a system, there is mathematics. 21 days, you give the right amount of heat to an egg, and 21 days later, a chick hatches. A chick comes out, right? With fully formed wings, beak, eyes, lungs, a digestive system, and there is nothing inside that shell. You can't go in, nothing comes out. Just the right amount of heat, 21 days. Okay, not more, not less. Who the hell is doing this? Is this an accident?
There's a scientific explanation for that, but I see what you're saying when you're pointing out the universe.
When it comes to explanations, you can make an elephant look like a pigeon. I saw a pigeon, so a pigeon came to my mind. And I'm from Pakistan. In Pakistan, the police can definitely do that. This is a joke, by the way.
Okay.
There's a joke about.
I think I'm following.
There's a joke
right
about the Pakistani police. That there was a big businessman who had his private zoo. He lost one of his deers. Someone stole the deer or someone killed the deer, and he called the police. You have to find my deer, or I'm gonna do X, Y, and Z. The police gets worried and they go, and then they bring an elephant after a while, right? And they are beating the elephant. The elephant is saying, I am the deer. I'm the deer. So the joke is that they can make an elephant confess to be a deer.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, that's the joke. So it was a side joke, it was a digression. Okay. But coming back to our point, what was the initial point, the elephant and the pigeon?
I don't know if he got the joke or not, but this is a very funny joke. People often tell it in Pakistan in particular. So I don't know if he got the joke. He doesn't seem to have found it funny, but we find it very, very funny.
So the joke is that they can make an elephant confess to be a deer.
Okay, yeah.
That's the joke. Gotcha. So it was a side joke, it was a digression. But coming back to our point, what was the initial point, the elephant and the pigeon?
Trying to prove things with scientific
concepts. Explanations, people, academics, scientists can do wonders. They can do wonders. They use this intelligence that has been given to them. It has been put in their minds. They don't even think about this intelligence. Where the hell did this come from? Can random blind processes give us cognition that we use today to reject the source of this cognition? I'm asking you a question. Can random blind processes, random blind unplanned processes give us cognition that you and I have?
This is a very powerful question. This is a very important question. Can we get intelligence, cognition, ability to assess and make decisions from a dead, unplanned, accidental process? This is a very interesting question, isn't it? And this is one of the questions a lot of atheists and or self-proclaimed atheists and agnostics fail to address. Can we get cognition, intelligence, ability to assess and decide things? Can we get that from a dead process, from something dead, from a stone, let's say? Can we get cognition from a stone? Can a stone decide? Can a stone make assessments and reach conclusions, is the question.
I'm asking you a question. Can random blind processes, random blind unplanned processes give us cognition that you and I have?
Can random blind processes give us cognition?
Yeah. The cognition you and I possess
today. The ability to think?
Ability to think, to calculate, to assess, and to reach conclusions. This is what we call cognition.
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole science behind it. No neuroscience. And...
Of course, I know the science behind it. I don't study it, but I know there is science behind it. Of course, I am asking you a philosophical question. Can random, blind, unplanned processes give you the cognition you possess and I possess today?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't know.
No, the question is, the answer is no. The answer is no, because cognition is not random, it's not blind. Okay, we have the ability to think, to assess, to reach certain conclusions and draw conclusions, right?
Sure, yeah.
Yes?
Yeah, yeah.
This cannot come from blind, unplanned, random processes.
Yeah,
as scientists, some scientists, not all scientists, by the way, when people say science, they think science is all for atheism. No, there are actually the biggest number of scientists in the world are theists. Did you know that?
Atheists?
Theist, people who believe in a God.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Okay,
yeah.
Whether they're Christians or Muslims or Jewish, okay? The highest number of scientists, okay, in the world are theists. That's what my research tells me.
Yeah, anecdotally, I can speak to that too. I know a lot of different
Okay, so then,
doctors.
Then science, when you say science, what do you mean science? Science can be twisted. It can be used to make any argument. It can be used to make an argument for God. It can be, firstly, God is not a question of science as we know it today. Science today is Eurocentric. It has been developed in its current form in the West. And the West became agnostic increasingly, especially in the last two centuries. Okay, since the Enlightenment, since the 18th century, Western scholars, thinkers, philosophers, even philosophers of science, have been basically very naturalistic or empiricist in their approach to a science. Okay, they used a number of different methods to reach their conclusions, right? So, currently science is Eurocentric or it's more Westernized. Right?
In
the day, we had scientists working in the Muslim civilization for over 1,000 years. We had the best scientists in the world. But science wasn't like it is today. That science was not agnostic.
Science is not a monopoly of the modern age. Science is not a monopoly of the West or other nations or cultures. Science is a human endeavor. So science has been going on from the very beginning. Of course, it was primitive in the beginning. Humans started to develop things. They started to study more and more of natural phenomenon. Okay, And then they realized that there is a lot more for them to study. So the Muslim scientists, for nearly 1,000 years, they pioneered most fields of science. And it wasn't atheistic in its outlook. It wasn't agnostic in its outlook. It wasn't godless, for that matter. Okay. Today, some people claim that science is a godless enterprise. It doesn't have to be. So those scientists who are atheists or self-proclaimed atheists, for that matter, or agnostics, when they try to use science to disprove God, they are actually stepping outside of the boundaries of science, because science does not deal with the supernatural as we know it today.
In the day, we had scientists working in the Muslim civilization for over 1,000 years. We had the best scientists in the world, but science wasn't like it is today. That science was not agnostic or atheistic. That science was completely theistic, and they were still making progress. They were still coming up with theories and ideas, and that's why we are here today. We are standing on the shoulders of Muslim giants, to add the caveat, Muslims, right? Okay. Science today, right now as we speak, stands on the shoulders of Muslim giants. People like Newton in the 18th century and other scientists were directly inspired by Muslim authors from the Middle Ages, and science was not atheistic or agnostic at that time. Today, some bigots are using science somehow as an argument against God. It doesn't work. It doesn't work like that, okay? Because there are others doing the same thing. They are using science to prove God. And when we see science today, which is entirely naturalistic and empiricist in its approach, when you look at the philosophy of science, it defines evidence in a particular way, okay? And then everyone has to stick to that definition of evidence, and it brings it down to physical evidence, okay? Unless you show God physically, we're not going to believe him. So right. Therefore, God, because it's a metaphysical idea, it is a supernatural thing, it cannot fit into the domain of science as we know it today, because science is entirely naturalistic. Science does not comment on the supernatural. It does not deal with the supernatural. It has nothing to say on the supernatural phenomenon, right? So science is not relevant to our discussion, brother.
Science
cannot help us, nor can it, it doesn't help us, or it doesn't not help us.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, you can't. That's my issue with religion, is that you can't.
So don't use science in a discussion on God.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
But yeah, science is limited. It's limited by scope. It's limited by its definition of evidence.
Right.
So we cannot use science as a tool to either argue or argue for or against God.
And that's what sucks about it, right? Because if there was evidence to prove, or if science proved one way or the other, then
I
know it sucks.
The question, the metaphysical question remains, where did this all come from? The science doesn't tell you.
Yeah, I know.
Science doesn't tell you where it all came from, why it came. Science doesn't tell you where and why. Science is very, very limited. It can only go up to a certain limit, right?
And there's theories just like religion,
And that's why these atheists and agnostics, they call it the God of gaps, right? They call this God, you're just using this God to fill these gaps and all these, So
I only have a few minutes left, but my main purpose in coming here was to just learn a little bit more about Islam.
Did you learn anything today?
I did, yeah, a little bit. I guess where can I go to learn more? Is it a matter of reading this?
This is not a book. If you're looking for science in there, it's not a book.
I'm not looking for science. Okay. I just want to learn
this
more.
This is a book
Islam.
On metaphysical realities.
Okay.
This is a book revealed by the maker of all of this, we believe. And we have reasons to believe that as well. I have no doubt that this book comes from the maker of the universe, the entity. And he tells us what he wants from us. He's telling us in this book what he wants from. I am the one who made you. I'm the one who formed you. Look, for example, you go to chapter 2 of the Quran. It tells us who he is. Chapter 2, verse 116 and 17.
Now, off the dome. Nice.
I mean, I have some verses memorized. So, okay, it says 117. Chapter 2, verse 117. Originator of the heavens and the earth. Okay, that means the originator of the universe.
Yep, yep.
Okay, when he decrees a matter, he only says to it, be, and it is, it becomes. So he has the power to bring all of this about. This is not a question of science. This is a question of metaphysics, the supernatural. Okay? So all of this is supernatural, by the way. You choose to look at it through a naturalistic lens, through an empirical lens. You choose to do that. But there are other realities beyond your naturalistic and empirical lens that cannot be seen through that lens. This is what you have to look into, right? There is a reality out there that science fails to show you, cannot show you, does not have the ability to show you. That's it.
I will read it, brother, and I will come to a conclusion as best as I can.
Yeah, and if you have questions, keep coming. Are you from London?
No, I'm from the US, man.
Oh, you're from the US.
I fly back the 28th.
Oh, yeah. You're leaving soon.
Yeah.
Okay, but in any case, keep in touch. Stay in touch with us.
Yeah, for sure.
I don't know if you have our social media accounts. You can get in touch with
us. Can I find this somewhere? There's a lot of things going on.
You will find it there, but I don't know. These guys, there are so many comments in the videos. They don't have the they don't have the time to check all those comments. But yeah, I'm on Instagram. I'm on Facebook. You can find me, Adnan Rashid. My name is Adnan Rashid. You'll find these videos and you'll see my name there. Just type that name and message me and just hope that I see the message, inshallah. Because I get a lot of messages as well. So sometimes I can't respond. But don't stop. If you don't get a response from them or from me, don't stop your research. Look into these discussions. Talk to Muslim intellectuals. Intellectuals. That's a very important caveat. Don't go to an imam in the masjid and ask him questions he cannot answer.
So this was not an insult against our beloved imams. This was simply to highlight that our imams are specialists in certain areas of theology. Let's say they are trained to be imams of mosques. They are trained to do certain tasks and jobs, and they are not necessarily trained to address some very complicated questions on philosophy, on metaphysics, or on discussions like this, right? So they are not necessarily trained. There are exceptions. There are imams who can address these questions, but they're very difficult to find. So you have to go to the right people to find the right answers. You cannot go to the wrong person. You cannot go to a person who specializes in agriculture and talk to them about building cars. Okay, it's like that. So you have to find the right people to talk about the right point, and you will get the right answers.
Don't go to an imam in the masjid and ask him questions he cannot answer, because imams are not trained to answer these questions. You must go to Muslim academics and intellectuals who are able to address these questions.
Yeah, makes okay? sense.
I'm not saying imams are not intellectuals. There are intellectual imams, but not every single imam is trained in these kind of things to answer these questions or to address these points.
Gotcha.
Okay. Your name?
Charlie.
Nice to meet you, man. My name is Adnan Rashid.
Okay. Gotcha.
Thank you so much. Nice.
Let me get your Instagram. Let me write it down real quick.
Oh yeah.
I don't have service here, so I'm just gonna type it in my notes.
Okay.
Do you mind typing it?
Yeah, my name?
Oh, your Instagram.
Yeah, my Instagram would be Mr. something. One second.
If you just type in your name, maybe I'll be able to find it.
Yeah, on Instagram, there's only one Adnan Rashid, so far I know.
Okay.
Not being arrogant, but there's only one Adnan. That I know of, okay?
Gotcha.
So, inshallah, if you Instagram might be the best place to
okay.
remind me who you are.
Yeah.
We had a conversation and you have more questions. Can take it from there, John.
Awesome, man.
Okay, thank you so much. Charlie. Thank you very much.
I don't know if it's very nice.